thought leader and speaker. Dr. Ryland is a researcher and speaker on the impact of technology on society, work, and careers. She's a former visiting scholar at Stanford University, leading leadership positions at Apple, HP, Cisco Systems, adjunct professor for the Bay Area Colleges, teaching classes in business, technology, and women's workforce topics. You've authored 11 books, appeared on CNN, Fox, CBS News, and in the Wall Street Journal, Chicago Tribune, Forbes, what else? Dr. Ryland was named San Francisco Woman of the Year and honored by the San Francisco Business Times as the most influential woman in Bay Area business. I'd like to introduce Dr. Tracy Ryland.
Gender, generations, and leadership. And what I'm going to do is share with you some of the results of research studies that I and my teams put together a couple years ago as we were learning more about the shifting landscape of modern day leadership. And what we wanted to do is really see what's going on with women or men or the different dynamics today in our businesses. And so we did two research studies. One was a qualitative study where we interviewed hundreds of executives, men and women in different companies. And one was a quantitative study where we sent out surveys to over 4,000 or 5,000 different men and women in different positions, direct or above in organizations. And we asked them to assess themselves, each other, men, women, ages, on leadership today. The modern day skills, attributes needed for leadership, and how would they rank them? How do they view women and men? And we had some very interesting findings. And so we wrapped it all up in this big book, really dense, lots of charts. But today I'm just going to talk to you about some of the findings that were the most interesting about it. So number one finding was women ranked women highest on all modern day leadership skills and characteristics. Right? I mean, you think about it, women are ready to see women in leadership positions. So then we said, oh, but if men rank men highest on all of it, then maybe you have to throw the study out, right? But they didn't. Men did not rank men highest on all leadership, modern day leadership characteristics and attributes. So then it gets really interesting because then you say, ooh, where are the differences occurring? Are we really looking any more about this male-female thing, or are we looking at something else? And I said, you know what we should do? Let's slice the data by generations. Because today, we are living longer, and we have 3, 4, and 5 generations in the workforce, if you can believe it. Now, you can look at this chart, look at your birthday, see where you fall in a generation, but pretty much most companies today have 3 generations in the workforce. They have Millennial Generation Y, they have Generation X, and we have the Baby Boomers. But we also have people like McDonald's and Walmart who actually have 5 generations, sorry about that. Okay? So we go to Hauerstrauss, which just to help us divide data. So we go by birth years. And if you are think you're a millennial and you would rather be a baby boomer, that's okay. That's okay, you can be whatever you want. But that's how we divide up the data. In our research, by the way, we only had 3 generations participating in the research. So we had the Y millennials, the Generation X, and the baby boomers. To make it really simple, they kind of say like 56 and up is the boomers, and somewhere in the 40s and 50s, early 50s is Gen X, and then kind of now the 30s and younger is are you millennials and why? Okay, so now we slice the data, and here's what we found that getting more interesting. With the men, Generation X and Y men were pretty much gender agnostic. So they didn't rank men or women highest or lowest on any leadership attributes and characteristics, which is very interesting because it makes sense. As we interview them, they say, well, let's face it. I grew up, our generation, with 2 working parents. I grew up in a household with grandparents, parents, and siblings. I grew up in a household with only one parent, right? Or somebody else, right, in a shared environment. So my world does not have a gender lens. My world is good leadership skills are good leadership skills, right? Really empowering, right? So where were the differences? Well, we found the differences with our baby boomer men, which also somewhat makes sense because their world and context of leadership in firms is very different than other generations. So here's what we decided to do. Let's dive deep into the baby boomer men results and see what they think about women and men in leadership. So they said, well, women excel in communication, mentoring, coaching, empathy, collaboration, and inclusiveness. Men, however, make quick decisions, have vision, and strategy. Women excel in people skills, but men are much more confident and take bigger risks. So I started to think about some of these TV shows that I watch every once in a while. Do you remember this show called 30 Rock? It's kind of off the air, you might remember it. Doesn't matter, it's Alec Baldwin and Tina Fey, so you know them. I'm gonna show you a couple little clips from it. It really was a parody on a company called General Electric, GE. And a really well-known CEO, Jack Welch. And many baby boomer executives loved Jack Welch because he was the strong leader, hierarchical, command control, quick decision, lay off the bottom 2%, promote the top 2%. This is how you want to be a leader. And we had a lot of baby boomer executive men following and using Jack Welch as their mentorship to success in leadership. Well, let's just take a look at that quick decision making. Is that even relevant anymore in our modern day firms? So I'm just going to show you a little snippet of our Jack Donahue, whose mentor is Jack Welch, trying to help Liz Lemon, who's his protege, and he really wants her to become a strong leader, giving her advice on how to make a quick decision. For example, how to fire somebody, right, to be a good leader. Let's take a quick look.
Fire her? And don't ever make me talk to a woman that old again.
I can't fire Rosemary.
Yes, you can. It's easy. Observe. Jonathan, you're fired.
Okay, so number one, this stuff didn't really happen in company, right? So number one, if I asked them, and I said, tell me what's going on, right? And they said, well, a lot of us actually came from families. Leave It to Beaver was our world. The mother's right role was the household and the kids. They never worked. We never saw women at work. We also went to the military. We had command-controlled structures. We only worked in companies, and they were really tough. This is how leaders succeed. So when I went out and interviewed other women and men about this, they said, see, that style of business is sort of turning into legacy because companies have really evolved. Companies are much more complex. We are now in a knowledge economy. We are in a service economy. And today, business is about people. And women excel in the people business. And leadership today, different than the past, is about relationships, about teams, about collaboration, about empowering your staff, and about trust. So that's some of the changes. However, many of our executives said, the one thing we should think about is that taking a risk is something that does differentiate us as leaders from others. Many of the executives said, what really put me ahead of the pack is that when I took a calculated risk, maybe it was the overseas assignment, maybe it was starting up another office, maybe it was moving into a new functional area, but that's when I really changed right into a different leader. Okay, to be a leader, the advice of our executives is, think about taking calculated risks. Entitlement is out. Staying at a firm for a long time does not necessarily mean anymore that you will go up the ranks. It's the people who contribute, generate new ideas, and continue to innovate. It's about getting sponsorship, people talking about you in a positive way before you even enter the room as the key person that they want to move up or have on a team. To expand your skills and look for opportunities both inside and outside of work where you can grow. And to seek visibility through special projects, assignments, lateral moves. This is what it is today to develop leadership skills. Now, we also talked about this whole concept of you're living to 100. That's a reality. The research is actually coming out now and saying, no, 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 you're living to 115. And babies born today will live to 150. Well, that changes the whole landscape about work, doesn't it? You're going to be working a whole long time. And you're going to be leading many generations in your groups. And you know what that means, because every generation has a different idea about work. And every generation has a different idea about leadership. And every generation comes in with a different expectation and a different education background. But you know what I hear about the most? Is every generation has a different idea about technology, right? Some come in and say, why are we not on an app yet? Shouldn't everything be on an app? Email, what are you crazy? Let's just do social media. Other generations say, whoa, we've been very profitable in this firm without technology. Like, it's not broken. Seriously, we have to fix it now. Right, why mess up a good thing? And then there's other generations like me, you know, I sort of didn't grow up with technology, but I see the efficiency of that. It makes me think about this, you know, I like to watch YouTube. It makes me think about this one clip I saw. It's about a young woman, presumably a millennial. She decides to give her dad an iPad. He's presumably a baby boomer. For us, as a birthday gift. And she says, oh, I wonder how he's doing with the new gift. So she says, she's dead, I'm gonna swing by. She has a conversation with him. How's the new iPad gift going? He goes, oh, it's just great. The problem is he thinks it's a cooking tool. Let's take a look.
Sag mal, Papa, hab ich dich noch gar nicht gefragt. Wie kommst du eigentlich mit dem neuen iPad zurecht, was wir dir zum Geburtstag geschenkt haben?
Gut.
Mit den ganzen Apps kommst du klar?
Was denn für Apps? Geh mal mit den Schiff zur Seite.
Young and with a baby before, you know, she's still a hot mama, right? right? Why wait? Now, Liz is probably our Generation X, and her generation was, well, wait a minute. First you work, and then you get married so that you can afford to have the kids. So they both come from different perspectives. Let's just take a look at Liz talking to Sari about having a kid.
You're so young, Sari. There's no big hurry to have babies. There are other things in life, like having a career, and working, and having a job, and working. You can have a career at any time, but you only have a really short period where you can be a young, hot mom. If you wait too long, you could be like 50 at your kid's graduation. 50 is not that old, Sari. Oh, I'm sorry. Are you 50 now?
So then we also asked about mentorship. And I'm glad that we talked about earlier today about the mentorship program, because in both our studies, mentorship was key. In fact, 94% of our men and women said that having a mentor was pretty critical to their success in their workforce, in life, and as leaders. However, the definition of mentorship has somewhat changed. So let me just bounce back now to Jack, who his mentor was Jack Welch, right? So he's talking to Liz saying, I want to be your mentor, because Jack Welch was my mentor. And she says no. Not only does she say no once, she says no twice. Let's take a look at this.
Then I like to think of myself as a winner. I like to surround myself with winners. I see potential in you. Let me be your Jack Welch, let me be your mentor.
No, thank you.
That is unfortunate. Okay. Liz, I'd like you to meet Howard Jorgensen.
Liz, how you doing?
He's the vice president of Locomotives Enterprise and Star at GE. I know the two of you had a lot in common.
You are relentless.
Look, Howard, you're obviously an attractive and confident guy, and at a different time in my life, I could definitely see the two of us together.
I'm married with two beautiful kids and a pool.
Liz, I wasn't trying to set you up. I wanted to show you my handiwork. I used to mentor Howard.
I was a lot like you. I dressed poorly, had bad posture. But Jack saw potential in me. He changed my life.
Now Howard's earning seven figures and he's married to a small Filipino girl.
Look, I told you, I don't need a mentor.
The one person can't take control of your life, tell you how to dress, tell you how to date, tell you how to do your job well, tell you how to get ahead. What you really want to have is a personal board of advisors. You want to have the go-to people, the buddies, that you can go to many of them because it is so complex. Maybe it's somebody inside the firm to help you with finances. Maybe it's someone in another department to help you with technology. Maybe it's outside the firm, somebody who's been doing what you've been doing for many years and give you guidance. Maybe it's a friend to help you with kid stuff, right? So having a personal board of advisors or creating go-to people that you can go back and forth and pick their expertise. Because let's face it, they said you don't want to follow one person because if they leave or change direction, you want to make sure that you have a robust infrastructure and network of advisors, personal board of advisors, go-to people's buddies, as mentioned today. Very important across the board. We had very interesting results when it came to the two studies on negotiating. On the quantitative study, the survey, both men and women actually ranked men higher in negotiating skills. But on the qualitative interviews, women came ahead at like 85%. In fact, many executives say that business negotiations, you absolutely want a woman at the table. Absolutely. Because they prepare, they listen, they collaborate, they solve problems, right? They see the big picture and the win-win, which is what negotiating is about today, because it is. It's about large projects. It's about global projects. It's about large ticket items. It could be about patents, right? You can't afford to have a win-lose situation in negotiating. However, I tried to figure out what was it that I had conflicting results. And I said, I bet this word negotiating, when you write it on a survey, brings up some negative connotations. And maybe people had images in their mind of negotiation. So I went back out and said, if I say to you negotiating, what do you think of? And a lot of people said, particularly the women, said, you know, it makes me think of haggling for a car. It makes me think of, you know, being at a bazaar, right? And going back and forth and haggling and nickeling and diming over something. And that's very aggressive. In fact, I think of it as being very hostile. I don't view it as being very win-win. And I said, oh, hostile? You mean something like this?
Opportunity, you want to go to a different branch office, or whatever it is,
Start to have those dialogues. Set up a one-on-one if your manager has time or if you have time for your employees. Set up a pattern. Maybe it's once a week, maybe it's once a month, right? And have this constant dialogues of where you want to go, what you want to achieve. I had employees come to me and say, you know what, Tracy, I want to improve my speaking skills, but I couldn't find a class inside the company. But we found a class outside of the company. Could we as a group take it? Of course, right? If somebody, you start to come in and say, I want to improve this skill or I have a gap and I found a solution, I would embrace that as a manager and a leader. And I'm sure you would too. And also ask for feedback and insight. I had an employee who worked really, really hard, and she was so busy, 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 but she never bothered to ask the manager if she was working on the right things because she was just so busy. And it ended up that she was so productive, but it wasn't in the direction that her manager wanted to go. So check in with your employees, because if they're really, really busy, they may be going, right? Because people are just smart. They think of things to do, and they may be going off in a different direction. But also for yourself, check in with your leadership team to make sure. How can I grow as a leader? I think this is just a great topic, and I love this card. So what are some final thoughts here? Well, number one is invest in yourself, right? Because you really, if you think about it, you're a product. You have to generate revenue for a very long time, for 11 to 100, right? We're going to be working 80 years, let's face it, right? So now you have to start thinking of yourself as a revenue stream, right? How am I going to really get this machine, right, still going ahead? So invest in yourself. It isn't about the company, excuse me, taking over your career anymore. It's you. And you know what? It's worth it because you're worth it. Right? So think about things that you could do, whether it's a lateral move, taking a class, developing a skill, learning a technology or something, right? And just take the initiative to do that and encourage your employees to do the same. Number two is create a personal board of advisors who already have the infrastructure here through the mentorship program to start at work. But also look around outside in your family and friends for people who really shine in different areas of expertise that you could tap into to really build your own network and go-to people, because it will really help you through, right? As a lot of our executives say, you just can't go it alone anymore. It's just too tough. Number three is take on a challenge. They're great. Is the company in a high growth mode and there's a new group on the horizon that, could be really exciting? Take me there, right? Let's join this group. Is there an opportunity to substitute for maybe somebody who's on vacation or maternity leave or something? Raise your hand, yeah, let's get some skills. Is there a cross-functional team that might be implementing the new website or ERP system at work, and you don't really know anything about technology? Put me on that team, right? Let me see, I want to learn the language. I want to be a user. Think about ways that you can really raise your hand for high visibility opportunities, right? And if you don't know any, ask your manager. To ask their manager, to ask their manager. I have this great, you know, high capacity person who wants to grow in the company. Where are the high visibility opportunities for them? Where can I direct them? And let's get you moving in that direction. Because it's all about cross-functional, lateral moves, and building a lot of expertise. And number four, be introspective. Is it time for a career selfie? I actually wrote this blog a couple of years ago. I saw a statistic by Google. We take 70 million selfies per day on our Androids. This is what Google found, not even including the iPhones. No wonder these phones blow up, right? 70 million selfies per day. So I said, something's really wrong with this picture. Something is very out of focus. And I try to figure out how much time we spent on career planning. And the only statistic that I could find was that college students 2 years out of school still looking for work were spending an hour and a half a year on personal career planning. But we as working adults, we're doing everything else but planning our careers. We're going out to lunch, we're watching sports, we're planning weddings, buying cars, taking vacations, everything but doing career planning. And I said that I wrote a blog. I just said, isn't it time for a career selfie? Now, tomorrow morning, we're going to have a workshop. Hopefully you'll come. It's all about you doing some career selfie exercises. How do you articulate your needs, right? How do you get comfortable with talking to executives, right? How do you get comfortable with asking for a promotion or budget? Are you aware of how you're perceived in the firm or with each other? Do you own your own personal narrative? Do you own your own personal brand? Do you have a brand? Right? These are things that are part of a career selfie, in addition to creating a timeline and a goal for yourself. So hopefully tomorrow I'll see you, and it'll be all about you taking on and doing some career selfie exercises to enhance your career. The last comment I have, one last video for you. Negotiating. It's very interesting. Usually someone comes up to me and says, you know, negotiating, I'm not good at it. I think it's genetic or something, or it's an art, and only certain people are born with that skill. And actually, it's not. Negotiating is exactly that. It's just a skill. And you're never too young or too old to learn it. Let's take a
moment. I'm just saying, telling the truth is not in the cards right now. I thought you'd be excited to have an acting job.
If it's an acting job, we should get paid.
Yeah, you then get paid in experience.
I want to actually get paid.
All right, what do you want?
$600 for the day, plus overtime if we go over 8 hours. I'll do my own hair and makeup, and I want you to pay for the 6 week intensive acting camp that my mom can afford.
$50 for the day and a 2 week acting class at the YMCA nearest you.
$500 and 4 week acting class.
$300 and a 3 week class.
Done.
I would have done it for $500.
I would have done it for the experience.
Thank you for including me.